It's easy to talk about what we've already accomplished. It's comfortable to do so. But really what will make us successful is confronting what we don't know.
Yeah, I mean, we can talk about our history, we can talk about our Nobel Prizes, we can talk about everything we've done in immunotherapy, but really what we should be talking about is what's next.
How are you contributing to something bigger, and are you willing to put your neck on the line in order to make a discovery? Can you take that risk in order to make the world a better place, and what are you willing to put up to do that?
I think if you don't take risks, you will continue to save lives at the rate you're doing now. You are reinforcing what you already know.
If we're going to make a difference, we have to do things differently. We have to be bold. We have to do things that other people aren't trying or aren't willing to try or haven't thought of.
If one is not failing at all, it would suggest that you're not exploring enough. You're not exploring novel directions and you're not taking sufficient risk.
I think you should have a stomach for risk. If you don't, I don't think you should be here.
It's actually the risky projects which have the bigger chance of completely changing paradigm.
So the dangers of playing it safe are we don't cure cancer.
If you look at any research center, they're dependent a lot on state funding, local funding, federal funding. And with that comes a lot of strings.
The federal government is not interested in funding really crazy science. But you know what? Like, crazy science is the stuff that gets us to where we need to be.
The thing that fuels our time to be creative, those are dollars from donors that are unrestricted, that just allow us to focus on discovery and allow us to move the science forward.
Philanthropy provides the freedom and the flexibility for our researchers to try things or approach things differently.
Without that early donor participation in some really risky research funding, we wouldn't see the things that we're seeing today.
I find it heartbreaking to look at our young investigators who have been working so hard and have such great ideas, then can't find the resources to pursue those incredible insights. That really is just aggravating. We should never forget patients that have gone through therapies and how much they've sacrificed, their willingness to undergo other tests, other biopsies, be involved in clinical trials. They're the ones that are really taking risk.
I was open to trying something where there's more unknowns. Maybe it's the same dead end, and maybe my participation would be something that would help somebody else out of this terrible disease at some point in the future.
That's a kind of heroism that I don't think we as a society talk enough about.
If you talk to somebody who runs back into a burning building to get somebody out, it's like the fear factor isn't there. You just do it because it's the right thing to do. I was not perceiving that this is a life-threatening opportunity, but that it was a life-saving opportunity.
In a relapse setting, a single patient, one biopsy from that patient can lead to a breakthrough. And that's a gift that the patients are giving to us. Frankly, it's a gift patients are giving to humanity.
I'd love it to see our community become as brave as our patients.
If you had told me 15 years ago that we would take a very fundamental, basic research program in immunology And that would completely change the way cancer is treated across the world today. You would think I'm crazy, but that is literally what is happening.
The world is changing out there, in case you haven't noticed. As big a change as you're seeing in the outside world is happening in the tools we have to understand and treat cancer.
We now no longer have to ask one little question at a time, but we can simultaneously ask 10,000 and find that one answer that is going to lead us down a fruitful path to new therapies.
We have, in fact, seen just remarkable responses, situations that where I've been stopped in the hallway by my colleagues in pathology. They literally stop me in the elevator of the clinic building and they say, "What? We don't know what's going on. We've never seen something like this." The patient had a bone marrow full of their tumor myeloma cells 2 weeks ago, and now we can't find a trace of it. So that's the kind of promise that is out there amongst my colleagues, amongst patients.
This is not a time to be cautious. We need to appreciate that this is the place and this is the time where we can set the table for the curative strategies for literally decades, if not a century, to come.
So when our president announced that we would cure cancers by 2025, you know, part of me was like really anxious about this.
Initially I went, whew, this is overwhelming, right? This is incredibly ambitious.
A little bit daunting, but also very much inspiring.
It's risky to make that claim, but...
But I also think that given the rate of discoveries that we have, why is it that we could not actually set ourselves this challenge?
Gary's goal is 2025. I was ecstatic, absolutely ecstatic, because in saying it, he made it real. He inspired the researchers. He brought hope to patients.
That's what we're all here for, so let's do it. And you can't do it unless you think it might be possible.
To hit that goal, we need to have the resources available for us to ask these bold and brave questions.
Big, bold ideas take money. They take risk. They take entrepreneurialism. They take people who have a different way of thinking about science and a different way of thinking about business and a different way of thinking about impact.
So one can donate a dollar or one can say they've invested a dollar. And I choose to believe you're investing. You're investing the future. You're investing in your children and your grandchildren and anybody in this community or for that matter in the world.
If you're looking at risk reward, there's no greater reward than providing and prolonging human life.
I think there is so much good that can be done by the Hutch.
There are two kinds of people in the world. There are those that are sick and those that aren't. And those that aren't, I think, have an obligation to do everything they can to help those who are.
There are people dying every day. Like, we need to remind ourselves of that. I mean, the why now is why not now? And why the Hutch? Where else is it going to be?